sun is shining, it's not raining.
Yeah.
It's not until about 9 o'clock tonight. It's open, I hope you open your Bibles to Mark, the 11th chapter. This is a chapter where Jesus doesn't tell parables, but he acts them out. And two of these acting out events have been greatly misunderstood. And Mark wants us to realize that it's important for us to understand both of these, the cursing of the tree and the chasing of the money changers away. If we don't understand both of those, then we misinterpret each of them. Jesus cursing this fig tree because it had no figs. He leaves that story. He talks about the sanctuary and chasing the money changers away. He leaves that story, comes back to the fig tree story. So the first obvious question we need to ask ourselves is, why does Mark tell us that Jesus was hungry for figs? Have you ever been hungry for figs? No?
Yeah.
Fresh. Well, it's important to understand why Mark includes this story. Then why does he tell us about Jesus chasing the money changers out? Disciples walking, and they find this fig tree. Now, this is this one unique fig tree. It's just full of leaves. A good sign that there's a healthy chance that they'll have figs. But it wasn't. Now, part of that reason we ask that question why is because for the Jewish people, the fig tree was a metaphor. It was a metaphor for the nation of Israel. So, one of the reasons that Mark includes this story is because of that. That fig tree often symbolizes both the health of the nation of Israel, both physically and spiritually. And so when Jesus is addressing that fig tree, he's really addressing the nation of Israel. And Mark tells us that story before he tells us about the money changers, and including his editorial comments. He tells us that it was not the right time for the figs. Now, obviously, Jesus would know that. He grew up, he's lived in Jerusalem's life, in the greater area of Israel's life. He knew that there was a low probability there would be figs in the tree. And when he didn't find any, verse 14, he says, may no one ever eat fruit from that tree again. In the book of Mark, this is the last recorded miracle performed by Jesus. And it really bothered the disciples because they had never seen or heard Jesus kill something. He does in this miracle. He brings the end of this tree, this tree's life, to an end. May no one ever eat fruit from you again. In Desire of Ages 582, she says, the cursing of the fig tree was an acted out parable. the barren tree flaunting its pretentious foliage in the very face of Christ was a simple symbol of the Jewish nation. I never thought of the fig tree as being pretentious and acted out that way. The Savior desired to make plain to his disciples the cause and the certainty of Israel's doom. Now, Mark tells us that Jesus was hungry. Now, Jesus has left Bethany. It's about a 45-minute walk to Jerusalem. And they left the breakfast table. And I remember one commentator saying, "Didn't Martha feed Jesus?" Well, Jesus wasn't hungry. He was hungry for a fig. You ever had the time when you've eaten, but there's just something, if you could just have this one little thing, that'd really be nice. In verse 13, I don't know if your translation says, "not the season" or "not the time." But I would encourage you to circle that word, whether yours says season or time. It was not the season for the figs. Mark wants his readers to realize this wasn't a spontaneous event. Jesus strategically planned this so the disciples would understand what the future holds. Now, that word time or that word season, the Greek word kairos, it's not a botanical term. It's not about plants. And if you hold your finger in chapter 11 and jump back to chapter 1, verses 14 and 15, we find that same Greek word. John 1, 14 and 15. Excuse me, Mark 1. Mark 1, chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. Now after that, John was put in the prison. That's why I got confused there. Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel to the kingdom. Preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying the what?
Time.
The time. That's that same Greek word. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. So when Mark records that it's not the time for the fig trees to have figs, he's using a Greek word that points to the kingdom of heaven, not to the fruit itself. Now back to chapter 11, verse 15. And they came to Jerusalem, and Jesus went into the temple and began to cast them out that sold and brought them to the temple, overthrew the table of the money changers, and the seats of them that sold doves. Now the temple had three courts. There's the altar where the priests would go into. Then there's the main court where the men went. And within that main court, there was a curtain off here where the ladies could go. Then there is the court of the Gentiles. That's where the money changers are at. That's where the people who are buying and selling the goats and the sheep and the doves, they're in the court of the Gentiles. And some believe that the Jews were allowing this to happen to show contempt to the Gentiles, to show how inferior they were as a people. The Jews viewed the main court and the court of the altar was at as sacred. They did not view the court of the Gentiles as sacred, and therefore it could be a marketplace. Now, some have also thought that Jesus was going to reform the temple. But there's really no evidence that Jesus was there to cleanse the temple. Yes, he was there to chase the money changers away. And the money changers are not really his focus. So we have three acted out parables. In chapter 11, we have the triumphal entry of Jesus riding on a donkey and the people singing Hosanna. The priests understood clearly this was a messianic presentation. The The second parable Jesus acts out is the cursing of the fig tree. Fig tree represents the nation of Israel. The third acted out miracle, which we act out parable, is chasing the money changers away. Imagine the temple was engulfed in all these shops and all this selling, and you had to buy the temple coin. If you didn't have the temple coin, you couldn't buy goats, or not goats, you couldn't buy sheep or doves or anything. And there's a major shift about to take place, and that shift is salvation. The focus is no longer going to be on the temple. When Jesus dies on the cross, the total focus is on Him. And the house of prayer is no longer the physical temple, but it's in heaven. In verse 16, Jesus says something rather odd, something I never thought about. And He would not suffer that any man shall carry any vessel through the temple. Do you realize that people were carrying their merchandise through the temple? It was a shortcut. Can you imagine people coming through the church as a shortcut to get to where they wanted to go? And I don't know if that meant they brought their camels or their donkeys, but they were carrying, it says they carried their vessels through the temple to get to the other side of the city instead of going around the temple. I can imagine why he'd be upset. It wouldn't be very reverent, would it? Have all the people bring them, especially like today. You know what's happening today here in New Smyrna Beach? It's a truck food contest. Can you imagine them coming through this church to get to where they needed to go? And I'm assuming none of you are going to go to the truck food thing today. And Jesus is heartbroken that the sacredness of the temple is being desecrated. And he's heartbroken that the Jewish people are really disrespectful of the Gentile people. Because they view them as inferior. They view them as forgotten of God and not worthy of God's mercy. Then in verse 17, he does an interesting word play. Verse 17, and he taught, saying unto them, is it not written, my house shall be called to, of all nations, the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. And I encourage you to circle those two phrases, house of prayer and den of thieves. Now, Jesus is quoting both Isaiah and Jeremiah. So if you want to, maybe in your margins of your Bible, Isaiah 56, 7, even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for what people?
All people.
All people. Jews and Gentiles. And then in Jeremiah 7, verse 11, it says, has this house which is called by my name become a den of robbers in your sight? Behold, I have seen it, declares the Lord. Well, Jesus is making this interesting wordplay, this conflict between the house of prayer and den of thieves. But who do you think he's referring to as den of thieves? It's a trick question, by the way. Who do you think Jesus is referring to when he says den of thieves? As you ponder that question, it's not the money changers. That's not who he's talking about. As offensive as they are, he's talking to the priests. You're hiding in the temple, pretending that you can be forgiven and still live however you want to live. The temple was intended to be a place of prayer, a place of worship. And the priest, in the inner sanctity of the temple, their lives were offensive to God. And when Jesus said, the house is to be a house of prayer, he never intended the temple to be a shrine. In Jeremiah 7:11 that I read earlier, Jeremiah is condemning the apostate nation for robbery, murder, immorality, idolatry, and turning the temple to a house of robbers. The people thought that they could blatantly commit sin and then find shelter in the temple of God. You think that's true today? That we find refuge in the house of God and yet still are robbers or thieves or adulterers or... See, the den is a place where robbers retreat after they've committed their crimes. It's their hideout. It's their place of security. It's their refuge. And calling the temple a robber's den is therefore not a cry of outrage against the outrageous business practices, but it's Jesus' heartbreaking feeling toward those priests who thought they could do anything, who thought they could sacrifice animals and still live a life of rebellion against God. Then in verse 18 it says, and the scribes and the priests heard it. They understood the triumphal entry. They understood about the person of the fig tree, and now they understand what Jesus is saying. And sought that they might destroy him. Circle that word destroy. It's not strong enough in the English language to destroy him, for they feared him because of all the people who were astonished at his doctrine. Jesus talks about some people unwilling to forgive a loved one because of the hardness of their hearts. These priests, their hearts were so hard, they had three opportunities to see the messianic parable act out. And now they want to destroy Jesus. And the Greek word there for destroy is a violent word. It literally means to murder. They were committed to murdering Jesus Christ at all costs. Yet here he has said three times, he has showed them in the acting out of the parables that he indeed is the Messiah. And they should have been humbled and opened their hearts and surrendered to him. Instead, they allowed their hearts to be hard. Verse 19. And when he was even, and when even was come, he went out of the city. 20 in the morning, as they passed, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling for remembrance, said unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursest is withered away. As I said earlier, this really troubled the disciples. They had never seen Jesus do anything like this before. And so Jesus begins in verse 22 to explain to them what that parable is about. And Jesus answered and said unto them, have faith in God. Really, we could quit there, couldn't we? Trust God, because in about 40 years, the temple is going to be destroyed. Everything that the Jewish people believed in was going to be taken away. And Jesus said, no matter how bad things get, have faith in God. He said, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed, and thou shalt cast into the sea, and shall no doubt in his and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he hath said shall come to pass. He shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and ye shall have them. And when you stand praying, forgive, if you have aught against any, that your Father which also in heaven may forgive your trespasses. We know that salvation is through Christ. And if we accept Christ into our hearts and our minds, we know we have the assurance of salvation. But how do we know that we've actually accepted Jesus? And Jesus says, verse 26, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you. Jesus wants to sit on the throne of your heart. I was ministering to a couple in Fort Smith, Arkansas. The wife was a whore, and the husband was in an A bar. From the master bedroom to the master bathroom was a very narrow path. From the master bedroom to the kitchen was a very narrow path. And if you wanted to cook, you had to take the stuff off the stove. And if you wanted to sit at the table, you had to take stuff off the table. Every room in the house, the piles were 6-7 feet high. Because the house couldn't hold everything, they had bought two sheds. Those sheds were full. The garage was full. Try to imagine Jesus trying to sit on the throne of your heart. If we've got all these other things hoarded in there, if we're hanging on to all these other things. Jesus is not content for a narrow path. He wants the full access of our heart. And he tells us, you know that he has that. When someone offends you, then you forgive them. Because it's a choice we make. You forgive them. And I was really struggling with this sermon because the Lord brought to my memory someone who I've never met, who I've never talked to, who's never talked to me, but offended me. And I didn't realize, I was working this sermon, that I was still unforgiving to that person. So I had to say, Lord, take this away from me. Because we don't have the power to forgive people. But God does.
Amen.
He is more than willing to empower us to forgive. If we don't forgive, we become like the den of robbers. We become thieves. And we hide in the church, pretending that's okay. And like the priest, our hearts become hardened against Jesus. So if there's anybody in your life that has offended you, allow the Holy Spirit to work on your heart, to soften your heart, so that you're empowered to forgive them, to allow your heart to be softened, and to allow Jesus to sit on the throne of your heart. Because as was mentioned in the Sabbath school lesson, we don't want to spend another 200 years here. Some of us don't have that much time. We want to experience the joy of the soon coming of Christ. We need to let Jesus have full access to our heart. We cannot afford to be hoarders. Jesus said, come unto me, I will make you fishers of men. Come unto me is the secret of bringing healing to our heart. To my knowledge, there's no known cure for hoarding. But there is a known cure for sin.
Amen.
And that is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for Jesus. Lord, help us to be real with you. And not to be hiding like thieves in a den. But to be open and honest with you and be transparent with you and allow you to clean us from the inside out. I pray in Christ's name. Amen. not to be unfruitful like the fig tree. Help us not to live a life that's a lie, but to be truthful and honest and be transparent with you. Help us not to be like the nation of Israel, to be unfruitful. Help us not to be robbers in a den. Help us to be your faithful people. I pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.